Velkommen til Ældre TV. I dag skal vi på besøg på Davids samling. Og her skal vi se op og se den islamiske samling, som er unik og som har nogle virkelige skatte. Vores gæst inde på museet er Bashi Qureshi. Og programmet kommer til at foregå på engelsk, fordi Bashi, han kan bedst forklare alle disse islamiske symboler på sit eget sprog, som er engelsk. Hvis billederne er lidt mørke, så er det fordi, at der ikke er meget lys derinde. Det er for at beskytte de udstillede genstande. Så hvis ikke man synes, man kan se nok, så må man selv komme på besøg. Det er et gratis museum, og det er åbent for alle.
This is incredible, I have. It must be very good for school children. I heard there's a lot of school classes.
They come here, that's true. And this is such a systematic way of explaining Islam that it says the religion of Islam and
five... You can do the English one.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Yeah?
We start with Islam, the religion, and the five pillars of Islam, then Prophet's life, and then Mecca and the Kaaba, what it means.
Yeah.
And then the split in Islam, which became Sunnis and Shias,
yeah.
And then the what is a mosque. And this is explained in a way, because if you just touch it, for example, you can see a mosque.
Yeah.
And that it then here you have different explanatory thing and characteristics, you know.
Yeah.
So I think it's a very beautiful way of explaining to those people who don't know much about Islam. So
and
I think
we were just talking about Islam in China.
Yeah, exactly. You see that you have that works of
and all the other medical sciences,
yes.
Which I think is very interesting.
Oh yes,
because a lot of our medical knowledge, Muslim knowledge,
it comes from Islam. Islam. World, that's true.
Yeah.
Until 18th century, the canon of medicine was from Arab world. Which was taught in the universities here.
Yeah.
So I think the museum have done a fabulous work with all these modern gadgets where people don't have to go through; they can just look at the same at the same place all those information.
And also, sort of telling it in a simple way.
Exactly.
Because there's a lot of background history, and if you are here with 30 children, you can't go in such details.
No, that's true.
So, and in the next room. They have a lot of computers.
Oh yeah, that's true.
Where people can check
more
it out
information.
Themselves.
Yeah.
And this is also the name of Allah.
This is actually a combination of different things.
Yeah.
In beginning it says, I start with the name of God who is very kind and merciful. And then it continues by saying that Prophet Muhammad is his prophet, you know. And then we have to go on the righteous way. So it's just like a combination of different things. But
are you able to read it?
Yes. Because it's very common in among the Muslim to read this.
But I'm thinking sometimes, is it possible for all Muslims to read all the scriptures? Because the writing must have changed over the years.
Well, the writing have changed, but the words have not changed.
Yeah.
So all Muslims who read Quran, which is written in the same script almost, so they can recognize what it is. And many Muslims, even they don't understand fully, but they can read it. It's like Latin in old days, you know.
Yeah. And then you can highlight different areas also here.
Yes.
The Islamic coin collection, for example. Oh,
yeah,
a lot of different ones.
It is.
Yeah. So it says all about all the different areas and their coins.
Yeah.
This would.
And there are different dynasties. You can see from 6th century, 7th century, then goes all the
Umayyadas.
Way to Umayyadas,
yeah.
To India, which is in 18th century. So you can see all this 1100 years period is shown in different dynasties, in different areas.
And some of the names are so, for us, you know.
Well, for Europeans, it's very difficult.
The Turunids and the Fatimids.
Fatim is the Egyptian dynasty. The Turks, the Seljuks, you know.
Okay, the Ottoman Empire. And what do we use that word for here? The sofa.
It's true?
Ottoman, that's a sofa.
Okay, I didn't know that, but Kais was a great empire, so Europeans were very pleased to have sofas to sit on.
It was very fashionable at the at the beginning of
yeah.
the last century
yes.
to wear a Turkish red hat, you know,
oh, yeah.
and lie on your ottoman and
the
smoke the no smoke other
pipe
or the hookah.
Hookah, yeah.
Yeah.
It's made of marble.
It's made of marble. It's called a jali.
Yeah, jali is this, you know, like
the way
mesh.
It's been
mesh.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's quite new actually.
It's quite new, yeah.
Yeah.
It's from the last part of the last century.
Yes. But this has been used in many royal buildings
yeah.
and also upper class people
mm-hmm.
because it is so hot.
Yeah.
So they have this sort of wind circulation,
yeah.
you know. Yeah. And then there is another use of that is that it was used where there's a separate women-men
yeah.
departments.
Yeah.
So they can, you know, if they
but
don't
they
want to see each other, they can talk to each other.
They
and
can still talk, you
yeah,
know.
Of course.
Oh, they must be able to see a little, you know. Oh, she has beautiful
yeah.
eyes.
Yeah, but look at the intricate
yeah.
work. Actually, this is a flower. You can
yeah.
see this is like a plant, you know,
yeah.
with the flowers in the handbag.
It's strange, it's not a lotus, you know. Lotus is always used in India.
That's true, but this is from the Muslim time.
Yeah.
So it has not very much focus on lotus, but the whole
yeah.
plant.
And it says it's a copy of the Red Fort from one like this, sitting in the Red Fort in Delhi.
Yes, as you know that Red Fort was made during the Mughal time,
mm-hmm.
which was one of the great dynasties in India.
Yeah, it's a beautiful building.
Oh, Agra, forts, many, many other mausoleums, gardens they have made in Pakistan. There
yeah.
is a Shalimar garden, a beautiful, like a paradise. You know?
And they're very good at keeping these buildings.
Oh, yeah.
yeah. But this is a fake.
Or
a copy.
Fake. It looks like you're going to get it from. So
yeah.
somebody made a copy to use it in normal house or some other place, you know.
Oh,
but
the English were quite good at
They did it too.
Bringing
you know.
Stuff they weren't really supposed to.
In India, they didn't do a lot of good stuff.
They did a lot of things.
Yeah.
But they did some good things in India.
Really?
They taught them how to make copies, you know, in seven copies of every piece of paper
uh-huh.
in the administration. They made the railway system.
Do you know why they did it? The copies?
Yeah.
So that it can go to different departments.
Yeah,
you
know? I
know. So
but
keep an eye on
Indians still use this system.
Of course, yeah.
And they made the railway system.
Railway
which is
system
a good
was
yeah.
a very good thing, but
yeah.
remember that was basically to transport the British troops.
Of course, you know.
So it was
they didn't do it for the sake of the Indians.
No.
But the Indians have a lot of advantage
oh,
of having
much.
Such a good railway.
Very much.
So it wasn't all bad.
Yeah.
And the last one we had was this now we're sitting in one of these open storage rooms
yes.
of the museum. And I think we need to talk a little about who this C.L. Davy was.
And why he started this
collection. C.L.
David
was originally of a Jewish family. But his family came to Copenhagen from Germany, Altona, which is a sort of a suburb of Hamburg.
Oh yes, that's true.
And originally they were Orthodox Jews, but that was the founding forefather. And later on they assimilated and they took Danish names. But still, you know, the old father who was the first person coming, he insisted that if any of his children would inherit his money, they would have to marry a Jewish person. And he had two daughters and three sons. The daughters were more obedient than the fathers. One married a Jewish person, another married a prince.
Okay.
And that was sort of almost as good as being
not bad.
Jewish for the father. But the boys, they didn't want to go into this tradition of Orthodox Jewishness, so they became Danish by being Christians and having Christian names. And, the David who started this museum C.L. he was called, because in those days you never mentioned the first names in full. You always said the initials, C.L. David,
yes.
Jose Ørsted, Jose Andersen, in this tradition. And he was a lawyer, and a very skilled lawyer. He was actually a lawyer of the High Court. And he, of course, he inherited a fortune, but he also made it much larger, not only by his business as a lawyer, but especially because he was sitting on the board of many big important companies at the time.
Okay.
So this way, he had a very good connection to all of the industrial life in Copenhagen, and he profited on this.
Right.
He never married. So instead of having a family and raising children, he started to collect art. And already as a young person, he was interested in art. And also from his background, the family had beautiful furniture, had beautiful homes in Copenhagen. And eventually, when he became a very rich man, his collection of art became more or less of an obsession with him, I think. But why he started this Islamic collection was because he had a very good friend called Emil Hanover, and Emil Hanover was the director of what we call the Museum of Art and Industry, Kunst- og Industrimuseet
in Copenhagen.
And David was very involved in this museum, and this friend of his, Emil Hanover, he suggested to David that he should start a collection of Islamic art, because it didn't exist in this area. And so he started out buying things from this this type of art. Mm. He never went to Persia, he never went to the Middle East or Iran or Iraq or Egypt or wherever it came from. He went to Paris and to Berlin, and he knew a lot of good art dealers, and he knew the auction houses.
So to them he bought?
So he bought it that way. Which was also, in a way, a more secure way of doing it, but not so adventurous.
No, no. But he showed interest, of
course. He showed a big interest in this area, and this collection he has is unique.
Yes, but I understand also, Fanny, that in his own lifetime, before his death, the Islamic collection was not so large.
No, it's big.
But then after he left the money and the board which was established, they did a lot of effort to collect all the stuff, not only in Europe but also from Muslim countries. And it is now the 10th largest art collection of Islamic art
in
the
fact.
World. Yes.
He also did something else. He donated the building or the house, Marienborg, out in the country for the Danish Prime Minister to spend his summer.
So that was also his?
That was also his, and he spent a lot of time there as he became older. And also being, you know, a strong man, when he went to Marienborg, he always chopped wood.
To stay fit.
And the guests were supposed to come and chop wood with him. So that was a sort of physical exercise.
And this house where we are, where the museum is, that was also his residence.
That was his residence and his family's house. Number 30 was where he, his family had lived, so he bought the whole house, and when he had the opportunity, he bought number 32, the connecting building, so this is where the whole,
so the whole
exhibition is located.
Exhibition is.
And then recently it has been redone. And we've seen all these new modern...
They must have spent a fortune on that.
Must have been a fortune. And you can go there and it doesn't cost any money.
Yeah, this is what I wanted to ask you, because I understand that a lot of students, young students, other visitors come to see this exhibition, which is amazing of value and quality, but it doesn't cost anything.
Yeah.
Because if
that's
you go
the beauty of it.
Because if you go to any museum, especially this kind, it costs a lot of money to come
in. It costs a lot of money.
So this, I find, a service to intercultural, interfaith living, so that all the students, both Muslim student, Jewish, Christian, they come here and look at different art and get this pleasure that we are all same people.
And also get an impression of the high level of culture in the Islamic countries. Because this is, I think, a very important issue here. And this whole collection totally evokes that attitude, because it shows, you know, at a time where we here in the north live more or less in mud houses, this kind of beautiful artistry existed already in Islam.
Yeah, but the good thing is that now the new generation, mm-hmm. the young students, they're learning from this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. That's what you're saying, that while Europe was in the Middle Ages and not much was going on, mm-hmm. that they were in other part of the world, in Spain, in Iraq, in Syria, in Turkey,
in China
and India. They were great civilization on the height of wealth, mm-hmm. prosperity, innovation, engineering, and that
philosophy,
architecture, that all this development moved from area to area.
Yeah.
Sometimes one area is very good and the other time the other area is very good.
It changes all the time. And also we saw on this huge map in the beginning how much spread out.
So this is one thing which I just also want to share with you, is that this what we call Islamic world is not one huge mass with one king and one government. It has been from the 6th, 7th century to 18th century, different dynasties and groups and families and kingdoms all over from Spain to India.
Yeah.
And each time this strong family or dynasty became powerful, they did a lot of good work, and then it moved to some other areas. Yeah. You know?
So, but it didn't go sort of peacefully all the way.
No, of course not.
There was a lot of internal struggle.
Exactly,
and
this is another thing which I think for our Western readers and seers and public should know, that there is no one Islamic thing.
No.
You know, there is Islam is a religion. Yeah. It's not a nationality. And it's practiced very differently from area to area. Yeah. Whether it is art, architecture, language, history, food, it's very different, you know. It's exactly like we have in Europe, you know.
But tell me one thing, because this is what I don't understand.
Please.
Today, we hear about that in Iran, there's a woman, they want to stone her.
Yeah.
The leader system and the religious system, they want to stone her because they say she committed adultery. And actually, this adultery was committed after her husband died. And this woman has been tortured. She's been tortured to give out a false explanation of how it happened on television. And then we sit here in the West and think, if the Islamic culture and the whole what we see here is on such a high level, how come that still today in 2010 they still go back to such ugly and medieval traditions as they do here?
You're right, and I also personally, and many Muslims don't understand, mm-hmm. that in 2010 in a country like Iran, which is quite developed in many ways, that there is a government who is doing that. The problem is that this way of stoning people to death is a very barbaric way of doing that.
Yeah.
And it is pre-Islamic. It has nothing to do with Islam. It used to be also before Islam came to the world.
But that is also a very long time.
Very, very, very long time back. But the people in Iran don't understand that in order for that woman mm-hmm. to be sentenced in any which way, mm-hmm. there should be four witnesses who have seen with their own eyes what happened.
Yeah.
And there is
no
independent witnesses, different independent. And it was to make sure that no woman is prosecuted that way. Mm-hmm. So there was a condition that four independent people have seen the act of penetration.
Yeah, for your four independent males.
Males, mm-hmm. so that nobody can lie to each other.
Yeah.
And now, because Iranian government is under so much pressure, it is based on a very strange form of their own interpretation of Islam.
Very strange.
Very strange. They use this excuse that it is religion to punish and silence the opposition.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with Islam. Islam does not say go and do this.
No.
Absolutely not. And I think that Iranian regime is doing more damage to Islam and to Muslim all over the world than anybody else.
And also to their own image.
Of course, definitely.
As barbarians.
Absolutely. And it's a pity because Iran does have a great civilization, which they should be presented. But I think that they have misunderstood the whole concept.
Totally.
Yeah. And I'm
and
sure.
And also because the man, I mean, you don't commit adultery without there's another person involved. And the man has been charged with nothing.
Yeah, but that is also very stupid because there's one thing in Islam is very important to remember that whether it is punishment or reward, it is both for men and women.
Yeah.
Islam doesn't say only women should be punished and not the man.
Yeah.
Both people who do adultery outside marriage has to be punished, but there is many different forms of punishment. Yeah. It's not stoning to death or kill somebody, you know. It's for example, if you do something wrong and you repent, that's fine. The repentance is the most important thing, that you say, I'm sorry, I did the wrong thing, and then that's it. But to go to this extreme form of punishment, to me, it is un-Islamic.
Yeah, totally. And only because her children were old enough to go on the internet and tell the rest of the world about
that
this case has come up. I'm sure there's a lot of similar cases that we've never heard about.
But I think the Iranian government is using that politically. You know, so that to pressure and, you know, to subjugate people. But one thing is also very important, Fanny, that we should not judge the whole Muslim world and Islam because of one regime who doesn't even happen to belong to the majority of Muslims, which are Sunni, whereas Iranians are Shia.
Yeah.
So there is also a very big difference there.
Can you explain that difference between Sunni and Shia?
Yes. Actually, according to Quran, there is no such thing called Sunni and Shias.
No.
Even Prophet's time, there was no such thing. What happened is that during Prophet's time, some people who were close to Ali, who was a son-in-law of Prophet, and his cousin, and a very, very close person to Prophet, thought that after Prophet, the caliph, or the ruler should be from his family, Prophet's family.
Okay.
Prophet has never said that.
Yeah. And this is Ali, his son-in-law.
It is not Ali, his friends.
His friends, okay.
After Prophet died, the people elected the wisest person, who was not Prophet's family, Abu Bakr.
But a good member.
Very respected man. He was elected as the first caliph.
He was the first caliph.
And then the second caliph was Umar, and the third caliph was Uthman. Number four caliph was Ali. And the interesting thing is, Ali has never said that I should be the caliph. It was his friends.
His friends who suggested him.
Exactly.
If you should compare the title of caliph to some other titles, there's no such thing comparable
because in Islam, the leader of Muslim nation should be both spiritual and religious leader, as well as political and commander of the followers.
Okay.
Like the American president, he's also commander in chief.
Yeah. So it's sort of like
president. It's like that. Plus that he should be also a leader who is righteous, who can be a good example to people, and a person who's practicing, you know.
This should also apply to the American president.
I hope so. Well, if an American president is a righteous person, does good things.
But anyway, so we were talking about the Shia and the Sunnis.
So what happened is that after Ali died, then his second son, second son, wanted to take over.
Okay.
And then there was this conflict between him and those who took over, and there was a war, a small war, where he was killed because he was very few in number, and that is how Shiaism, you know, continued.
Okay.
And
he was Shia.
In Shia religion, are part of Islam, they consider Ali as the first Imam.
Okay.
And then his second son, third son, four followers, and then they are waiting for the 12th Imam to come. This is a long complicated.
Like we've been waiting for Jesus.
But they are 15% of the total Muslim population. They are minority. The majority of them Sunnis, which follow the practice of Prophet Muhammad himself.
So the Sunnis are sort of the
85%.
The 85%.
They're the main.
So, but what is this? There must be some special aspects of the two ways of doing it, which are contradicting somehow, since they've been fighting so much.
It was a political fight. It was a power fight for the power. Not, in my opinion, it was not religion, because both Shias and Sunnis believe in same religion, same God, same Quran, same Prophet. Absolutely. The only thing is, they do not consider the first three caliphs as the righteous followers of Prophet.
So it goes back to this.
So it is the split, which is political split.
And they still exist as such.
Very much so.
Where do the Sufis come in?
Well, today in Islam there are 72 different sects.
Oh my God.
Yeah, but it's not, they all agree on basic principles. But the way you practice religion is different. Sufism is a lot to do with your private relationship with God.
Yeah.
Whether it is through meditation or poetry or dance, or meditation, whatever, but that is not a kind of a organized religion.
No.
Sufism is not a,
it's a personal religion.
It's a personal relationship. The man who founded Sufism, Jalaluddin Rumi, who is buried in Konya, he was asked by one of his religious friends, why not to come to mosque? So Maulana Rumi said, there are many paths to God. I have chosen music and dance.
Okay.
So that is why the Sufis is dancing, you know.
And that was a beautiful individual sort of
statement. And that is one thing, it's very important also to emphasize that among the Muslim communities of 1.7 billion people, there are many different ways of practicing. I come from Pakistan. In Pakistani Islam, there are many tradition from Hinduism, which came when Islam came to India, Hindustan. For example, marriage, tradition are totally Hindu.
Totally. You have these big feasts, and
henna, and a lot of stuff, you know.
And
many rituals also, sweets. The same way, if you look at the Turkish
and
Islam,
the food and everything.
Exactly. In Turkish Islam, there are many tradition come from Byzantine Christianity.
Okay.
And the same way in Arab countries, there is a lot of mixing of Christianity and Islam.
So it's all depending on like who are the neighbors.
Exactly.
This way, paintings.
Kings. And
princes.
Rich princes on whose order it was made.
Mostly of them. We are now in what they call the miniature gallery.
Yes.
And this miniature gallery is in fact the largest in all of the world.
There's
a public assets. There's a lot of private collections which maybe are larger, But this is where everybody can come in and look for themselves. And even if we think there's a lot of pictures on the walls, we also have the way of, we put them in the drawers, you know, so you can study them.
Yes, dear.
And you can see many more pictures than they already display on the walls.
Right. It's a very nice system, you know.
It's a very nice system. And I can only encourage people to come and look for themselves, because it's so detailed, we would not be able to go into all these.
Absolutely. And I would also say that those people who are from outside Denmark, if they come to Copenhagen, please go and visit David's collection.
Yeah.
They were in the part of the book. Because they were not separate paintings.
They were not supposed to go on walls.
No, they were part of the books. Yeah. You know, those big.
So that's why they have this miniature size.
Exactly.
And it must have
And it differs
it
from area to area.
It must have taken a lot of time to create these pictures.
Well, there was artisans and painters in the royal courts whose only job
was to
do that, like Raphael and you know, other great Michelangelo, who were commissioned by the big rich people. You know, so it's the same concept.
So it's the same concept.
Yeah,
but they are very beautiful, you know, and the incredible thing is that even if they are like 500 or 600 years old, the colors are still so lively and vivid, you know.
So the colors are made from mineral. They were crushed stones where they made very, very fine, which stayed so much, you know. It was not paints, you know.
No.
Either color or from flowers.
Yeah. No. So I'm sure a lot of these artists have lost their eyesight, you know, during this. Because if you sit there doing something very small every day, you lose your eyesight.
That's true. But then I'm sure that beside the master painters, they had a whole large army of their students who were also helping them.
Yeah, I think they started out with the calligraphers,
exactly.
You know, doing the drawings.
Exactly, and then they were the ones that put the details in.
Yeah, and all the colors. but. You have to come and see it yourself, you know. In a program like this, we can't anyway try to give a true picture.
Yeah, on the silk.
Yeah. Fløjlsvævet tekstil.
Amazing, huh? Yeah. So see how intricate this is.
Yeah, it is.
Beautiful.
And it's from the 1700s.
Mm.
And also because we know that silk is a beautiful material. It keeps you warm when it's cold, and it keeps you cool when it's warm.
And it's good for the body.
Good for the body, but it has one little sad thing, is it dissolves eventually.
Quickly?
Yeah. Not quickly, but if you don't keep it in the right way, which they obviously do here, it's simply, you can blow it away in the end.
Okay.
And this is a piece that has 400 or 500 years on it.
It's amazing.
Amazing. Yeah. Silk. And what is it called? Velvet.
Yeah.
Velvet woven.
But these also, you can see the figures of
women,
you know,
what
that.
Women with the
standing,
children.
Yeah, standing in front of a plant.
And the funny thing is, typical, when you make pictures of children in the old days, you don't really make pictures of children, you make small adults.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, facials. Yeah.
You can even see
it
here.
So she's telling him, don't be naughty.
The mothers are very big.
Yeah, but this is also one thing I've noticed, you know, that in many of Eastern arts, that the proportion is not right.
Yeah.
You know, you can see the woman is so tall as the plant.
Yeah.
So it's just
a tree.
Yeah, exactly. Panorama.
Shall we say something about this?
We can talk about it. You read something, you know?
Yeah, this is the fritware. It's all fritware.
Wow.
crosses.
Okay. And you see there's also crosses here.
Yeah.
You see this?
Yeah, there's crosses, it's true. Yeah. One thing I've noticed, which is very typical of Islamic art, is the tiles department.
Yes.
It's incredible how many different type of tiles. And many of them, I think, are made in what they call fritware.
Yes.
Which is a specific ceramic way of making tiles and other pieces of art. But one thing we've noticed here is they also have crosses.
It's true, because these come from that area where there was a Christian influence before Islam came to that area. So in that tile you can see that you have different patterns, you know.
Yeah.
And these tiles are used both on walls but also on floors.
On the floors
and
too.
And you can see this great shine, you know, which is achieved.
Lustre, we call it in
exactly.
Danish.
Yeah.
I don't know the English.
And you can see these are for the walls.
Yeah.
And some of them they are very decorative with a lot of pictures of the family. Because can you see these are from Mughal times?
Yeah.
You know, with this face from Azerbaijan and that area.
Yeah.
You know. But still the Persian writing.
Elephants.
Yeah, exactly.
Pictures of elephants.
And horses.
Horses.
And flowers and
flowers.
All that.
Yeah. Always flowers. Yeah. And birds.
Yeah, it's amazing.
It's beautiful the way it's ornamented. It really is, and some of them are very intricate, and some of them are more coarse. Like
yes.
These.
Yeah. It's also because this is from the edge of the Islamic Empire.
This room or this wall or mantra is especially from Afghanistan.
Yes.
And as you say, there's a lot of Buddhist influence here.
Yes, but this is from the time of Mahmud Ghaznavi and Ghuris. They are two dynasties who are very, very powerful. And especially the Ghaznavis, Mahmud Ghaznavi, he was one of the big Afghan king who attacked India 17 times.
Yeah, you know? 17 times?
17 times.
Okay.
Before the Mughals came. And if you look at those, there's a lot of influence from the Buddhist and Hindu culture, because in Afghanistan, Buddhist culture was very prominent before Islam.
Before Islam. And that brings us back to the Bamiyan type here, which is all these bowls are called Bamiyan type.
Yes.
And this is also something that leads up to today, because this is where these enormous
big
statues
were, Buddha statues.
Buddha statues. And that was a very sad chapter of Afghan history, I think, where they destroyed the statues.
Because those who destroyed it, they are so ignorant that they didn't realize the historical value of those great statues. You know.
And this is a side of... And here we have some more pottery, beautiful pottery, which is very old, and it looks like...
Can you see that? It's very, you know, it's... It's an animal, and all this part.
Fable
animal. They are long before Islamic time, you know, they're very old.
Very old, 11th to 12th century.
Yeah, exactly.
And here you have also these beautiful small bowls. They are from the 1200. And then this is something that I impressed on, because this vase and this bowl, I've seen things in India.
Same type.
Okay, 30 years back, but still
no.
So many. And this is a beautiful shaped vase, which is perfect for putting in flowers. I dag er vi på besøg på Det Kongelige Bibliotek afdeling Nord, som rummer naturvidenskab og medicinske bøger. Og det er vi i anledning af, at vi snakker med Emil Bier, som jo har interesseret sig meget for disse sider af tilværelsen. Emil, hvad er det især, som du har koncentreret din interesse om?
Det, der interesserer mig, det er, hvad det officielle Danmark siger, og så virkeligheden.
Ja.
Og hvis der er forskel, der begynder det at interessere mig.
Altså et modsætningsforhold?
Ja, fordi det ser ud til, at de kommercielle interesser her i Danmark er langt større end den sandhedsværdi, de repræsenterer. Og så kan man godt nogle gange undre sig over, at vi har en topdødelighed her i Danmark blandt de vestlige lande. og vi siger en masse ting, der efter min mening er totalt usande. Det synes jeg er lidt synd for Danmarks befolkning, at vi skal dø før de fleste andre lande.
Ja. Når du nu siger topdødelighed, hvad baserer du det så på?
På international statistik. Det kan næsten ikke gøres dårligere. Jeg vil tro, at to Tivoli-kontrollører kunne styre Sundhedsministeriet bedre, end det, der foregår for øjeblikket. Fordi de lyver ikke.
Nej.
Det gør Sundhedsministeriet. De siger, at man skal drikke mælk hver dag. En halv liter mælk. Og det passer ikke. De lande, der drikker mest mælk, har mest dødelighed.
Ja.
Og derfor synes jeg, det er totalt useriøst, det der foregår i landet. Det minder om propagandaministerier i andre lande fra forne tider. Og det er nøjagtigt det samme, det der foregår i dag. Vi kalder det bare et frit samfund, men friheden er som så.
Altså, vi er jo alle sammen vokset op med den her bevidsthed om, at vi skal drikke mælk, ikke? Jeg tænker især på mange af de der gavlmalerier af Hiobs om i Sølvgade der med moren og barnet, som slutter af sundhed.
Ja, ja. Og der står, mælk er sundt.
Der står, mælk er sundt, ja. Så man kan jo ikke laste den individuelle dansker for at tro, at det...
Han tror på det. Han tror på det. Helt klart.
Og vi kan også se den måde, vi lærer småbørn at drikke mælk allerede i en tidlig alder, ikke? I stedet for, at de kan få modermælk længere tid.
De starter jo med en halv liter mælk i skolen, eller en kvart liter mælk. Mm. Lille Ole, det er vores børnelærdom, at mælk er sundt, men sandheden er lige omvendt.
Men de lande... har nu også andre lande, hvor de har den samme holdning. Altså, jeg er for eksempel vokset op i England i noget af min barndom, og der var der også den samme propaganda for, at man skulle give småbørn mælk.
Ja.
Og det interessante er jo, at småbørn kan slet ikke optage den kalk. De kan ikke omdanne den kalk, som er i mælken. Så det er faktisk den værste befolkningsgruppe at give mælk. Det er også derfor, der er så mange sygdomme i ører og næse, i bihuler. Og fordi de har store problemer med det mælkeoptag.
Selv kalven render jo væk fra koen efter få måneders kørsel. Ja. Det er jo kun mennesker, der løber efter en ko hele livet igennem.
Ja.
Det er jo, altså, jeg vil sige, det er noget af det mest unaturlige, der findes, at drikke mælk.
Ja.
Og der er ikke nogen andre dyre, der er så tosset for sit liv som os. Det er jo kun fordi Danmark er et mejeriland, at vi bliver fyldt med mejeriindustriens løgne og statens løgne. Fordi staten holder med økonomien og siger, at mælk er sundt. Og det passer ikke. De lande, der drikker mest mælk, har højst dødelighed. Jeg kan vise dig en kurve her.
Ja, det jeg tænkte, vi må komme.
Jeg kan vise dig en kurve her, som viser, der er en lineær sammenhæng mellem de lande, der drikker mest mælk, og deres dødelighed. Det er hjertekardødelighed, vi har heropad, og det er mælkeindtag per 100 kilokalorier per dag her.
Ja.
Og hver prik repræsenterer et helt land. Det er den kurve, danskerne ikke må se. Den er hemmelig. Den må ikke vises i Danmark. Den må ikke vises i danske skoler. Den må ikke vises på danske universiteter. Danmark bliver fyldt med løgn og siger, at mælk er sund. Der er tykke rapporter om, hvor sund mælk er.
Men hvorfor er det så Finland, der står deroppe?
Fordi Finland har et meget højt indtag af mælk per indbygger.
Ligesom
og det har Frankrig ikke. Det er derfor, Frankrig og Japan og asiatiske lande ligger helt nede i bunden. Og de nordiske lande og USA ligger heroppe.
Men jeg har da indtryk af, at i Finland spiser de meget mere fisk, og fiskeolier i det hele taget får meget af deres animal eller deres fedtstofindtag fra fisk. Så det er jo interessant, at de ligger lige så højt som os.
Men alligevel er det begrænset, hvor meget fisk Finland spiser i indlandet, fordi de har et meget stort indland uden særlig kystnære områder.
Ja.
Så alt i alt spiser de utrolig meget mættefedt, og de dør som fluer af det.
Men tror du ikke også, man skal se det i sammenhæng mellem, at vi både spiser meget animalsk protein, altså kød, ikke? Og vi drikker meget mælk, men at vi også har et stort forbrug i forhold til mange andre lande, og det gælder også Finland, af alkohol. Der er mange, der ryger cigaretter.
Jo,
og så den der uheldige alliance mellem mælkefedt og animalsk fedt, alkohol og tobaksrygning, giver så i mine øjne formodentlig det meget store...
Den høje dødelighed.
Ja.
Jamen, jeg vil sige, noget, som er rimelig interessant, som også er en hemmelighed her i Danmark, det er jo, at Danmark har ud af 37 lande det dårligste forhold mellem indtag af mættet fedt og umættet fedt. Det kan ikke gøres dårligere. Det vil sige, at disse fire Tivoli-kontrollører, de vil lave det langt bedre, fordi de fylder ikke folk med løgn. I Danmark siger man, at man skal spise mejeriprodukter med lavt fedtindhold og kødprodukter med lavt fedtindhold, men det skal man ikke.
Men det passer jo ikke, det er kostrådet. Som jo ligger dernede, de spiser jo meget ost også, ikke?
De spiser også meget kød.
Men til gengæld spiser de meget olivenolie,
tror jeg. Ja, og det er olivenolien, der gør, at deres dødelighed falder drastisk. Ja.
Altså, også meget vin.
Alle middelhavslandene har jo typisk en hjertekardødelighed og en kræftdødelighed, der er 2-3 gange lavere end det danske. Ja. Netop på grund af, at de får olivenolie i stedet for smør. Hvis du går hen i et dansk supermarked, så ser du primært kødfedt og mælkefedt. Ja. Du ser ikke særlig meget vegetabilsk olie. Og hvis du lægger mærke til, hvad tykke personer køber ind og mad, ja, så er de mange gange køber de mest usunde varer. Hvis ja, du kan næsten se på folks tykkelse, hvad de køber.
Hvad de køber, ja. Og ja, hvor meget er det, de
ja,
spiser.
Ja.
Men så har du simpelthen udmøntet meget af den her viden i nogle kosttilskud. Har du ikke?
Nogle kostråd.
Nogle kostråd, ja. Undskyld. Det er mig, der er
ja,
fejlformuleret. Og hvad går de kostråd ud på?
Ja, kostrådene går jo primært ud på, jo mere vegetabilsk mad du spiser,
ja,
jo sundere bliver du.
Ja.
Jo mere animalsk mad du spiser, altså kødprodukter og mælkeprodukter, jo mere syg bliver du.
Mm.
Mælk giver ca. 100 sygdomme. Man kan se det på nettet ved at slå no milk op på nettet, ja, hvor der dokumenterer ca. 100 ja, sygdomme. Og hvis man ser i den her bog her, der hedder The China Study, det er den bedste bog, der findes om sammenhæng mellem sygdom og ja, dødelighed ja, og sygdomme.
Mm.
Den må ikke bruges her i landet, fordi ja, Danmark er et mejeriland og et kødproducerende land.
Ja. Kineserne drikker ikke mælk.
Nej. Det vil sige, at den her bog er hemmeligstemplet i Danmark sådan rent mm, officielt. Den bruges ikke på universiteter eller læreanstalter i særlig stort omfang.
Ja.
Det var mig, der fik universitetsbiblioteket her til at købe
til at
bogen,
ja,
til at tage den hjem. Fordi man bruger ikke rigtig information her i landet. Det er et propagandistisk land, som mm, er pengestyret.
Ja. Og styret af de forskellige magteliter, der er rundt omkring, ikke? Altså lægestanden, for eksempel.
Jo, jo.
Som jo ikke er interesseret i, at der pilles ved deres status. Hvorfor de for eksempel heller ikke aldrig går ind på det mere alternative måde at behandle kroppen på. Og så de store giganter. Men det interessante ved kineserne er jo, at de spiser jo en del kød.
Ikke særlig meget.
Ja, altså
i forhold til amerikanerne spiser de måske, jeg vil tro, de spiser 5 gange mindre, eller 6-7 gange mindre. De har nærmest ikke kød i forhold til de vestlige lande.
Men derfor er det også interessant at se, hvad der sker i Kina nu. Fordi en af grunden til, at de ikke spiser så meget kød før i tiden, det er fordi de fleste kinesere var ludfattige. Og så spiser man ris, og man spiser nudler, og så lige ovenpå, så ligger der måske en lille smule kød.
Ja.
Eller som i Indien, hvor man spiser sådan en stor portion ris, og så ligger der 3 små fisk ovenpå.
Ja, ja.
Så det hænger sammen med, kan man sige, den almindelige sociale status. Nu er det, at nogle af kineserne jo er blevet frygtelig velhavende, og de andre
og
stadig
de
er blevet fattige, så vil de sikkert med stor sandsynlighed overtage nogle ja, af vores velfærdssygdomme.
Ja, okay.
Ligesom de har biler, ligesom de har tv, ligesom de har computer, ligesom vi har. Ikke?
Ja, ja. Jo mere vestlig mad de spiser, jo hurtigere
ja,
dør de.
Ja.
Og jo dårligere får det. Folks alderdom her i Danmark er jo også frygtelig, fordi de ramter så mange hjertekarsygdomme og så meget kræft og andre ting.
Ja,
så de simpelthen, gamle danskere, de er jo nærmest stået af 10-15 år, før de dør.
Ja.
Mens ældre medborgere i Middelhavslandene eller i Østen er jo meget friskere lige til
ja,
de styrter.
De
og det er et helt andet liv. Det er jo et helt andet liv. Jamen, ja, bedstemøderne passer deres børn. Herhjemme
ja,
har vi apparater og organisationer, der passer børn og gamle.
Ja.
Vi har organiseret det hele.
Ja.
Og de skal bare ligge i sengen og sige dut, så kommer der nogle folk. Ikke? Altså, derovre passer de deres børn. Det er de levende til det sidste. Det er jo et helt andet liv. De respekterer menneskets egentlige liv meget mere, end vi gør. Vi putter folk ind i kasser. Først i børnehave, så i skoler.
Mm.
Og til sidst ender vi på plejehjem.
Mm.
Okay?
Men der er jo nogle af os, der ikke har lyst til at ende på den måde. Ikke? Og der er det jo vigtigt, tror jeg, noget af det allervigtigste, når man bliver gammel. Det er et godt helbred. Altså man kan være velhavende, man kan være fattig, men hvis man har et dårligt helbred, så kan det være det samme. Altså.
Ja, og danskerne har.
Hvordan har du tænkt dig, for eksempel? Hvad vil du gøre for at være sikker på, at du kan være frisk til det sidste?
Jeg spiser så meget vegetarisk mad som muligt.
Ja?
Jeg spiser nærmest ikke andet end vegetarisk mad. Jeg spiser ej, fisk måske en gang om ugen eller sådan ja, noget der. Men i princippet er, jeg tror, jeg har 98% vegetar.
Ja.
Og det giver mig en fantastisk styrke. Det renser mine blodkar for kolesterolaflejringer og andre kalk-kolesterolaflejringer, der gør, at jeg undgår risiko for hjertekarsygdomme.
Hvad gør du for eksempel? Fordi det tror jeg også er meget, meget vigtigt. Det er, hvor meget bevæger du dig?
Jeg bevæger mig omkring en time om dagen.
En time?
Ja,
hvordan,
det tror jeg.
Hvordan tilbringer du den?
Jeg cykler, jeg ja, går, og jeg leger, jeg har nogle børn, jeg leger med. Altså, jeg er ret motorisk orienteret.
Du er ret motorisk, ja.
Og det synes jeg er fantastisk væsentligt. De fleste danskere sidder på kontoret, til de styrter, og de får rygproblemer og alt muligt.
Først sidder de foran computeren henne på kontoret, ikke? Og så sætter de sig ind i deres bil, og så kører de hjem. Så sidder de foran fjernsynet eller computeren derhjemme, og der er jo ikke meget bevægelse i det.
Det er derfor, man har lavet ernæringsråd om til også at være et motionsråd. Ja. Men problemet er jo, man har jo ikke taget højde for det, når folk går på arbejde, at de får en halv times gymnastik i arbejdstiden. Ja. Og de burde gøre. Det gør man i visse asiatiske lande. Ja, i visse asiatiske lande tager man hensyn til hele mennesket. Det gør man ikke herhjemme. Herhjemme er mennesket jo bare en maskine, der kan gå på arbejde 8 timer om dagen.
Ej, det er jo også lidt derude. Men så har man måske fundet ud af, at maskinen kører bedre, hvis,
hvis den bliver smurt lidt. Hvis den bliver smurt lidt.
Ja. Så på den måde, der kunne vi jo komme langt. Ja. Altså, jeg tror for eksempel, en af de værste forureningssyndere herhjemme, det er ikke så meget smøgeren. Jeg tror, det er alle de biler, der fiser rundt ude på gaderne. Og når, hvis vi ikke havde så mange biler, så ville folk jo også være nødt til at bevæge sig selv mere. Ikke? Hvis vi organiserede vores liv sådan, at arbejdspladserne ikke lå så frygtelig langt væk fra der, hvor man bor, så kunne man cykle på arbejde. Ikke? Altså, man kunne godt organisere samfundet sådan, at bilerne ikke var så utrolig livsnødvendige.
Ja, de smadrer hele byen.
Har du en bil?
Nej. Har du?
Nej. Jeg har ikke engang kørekort.
Så. Men jeg synes, det værste ved det her samfund, det er den der utrolige pengestyrede tankegang, der findes her. Hvor alt sammen er pengestyret. Kan man kurere sukkersyge helt? Det ved jeg med 100% sikkerhed. Kan man kurere ved hjælp af mad alene? Men det vil danske læger ikke kigge på. Nej. De er ligeglade. Og dødeligheden
for vi sælger jo rigtig sukkersyge. Meget insulin til resten af verden.
Så det er pengestyret det hele. Det er det, der er uhyggeligt. Ja. Altså, jeg ved, at dødeligheden for sukkersygepatienter er mellem 7 og 8 gange højere end almindelige mennesker. Det vil sige, at behandle folk med insulin, det er en dødelig gift. Det er en form for mor. Det er i virkeligheden en form for en åben koncentrationslejr, vi har her i Danmark, styret af Novo og hospitalerne og lægerne. Og de vil ikke indrømme, og de vil nærmest ikke lave forsøg med kost.
Når man først er begyndt at indtage insulin, så er man vel ikke i stand til at
slippe det igen. Jo, det kan man godt. Jeg har beviser på, det kan man. Og jeg synes, det er kriminelt, det der foregår her i samfundet. Jeg mener, jeg anklager lægerne, hospitalerne og hele det offentlige sundhedssystem for kriminalitet. De har lovet at overholde lægeløftet her i landet. Det gør de ikke. Fordi jeg ved, at de fleste sukkersygepatienter kan kureres ved kost alene, og det gør man ikke. I virkeligheden slår man folk ihjel for at få lidt penge til landet for Novo Nordisk og sådan noget der. Jeg synes, det er dovenskab, hensynsløshed, grusomhed og kriminelt, det der foregår.
Men Emil, når nu
jeg kunne godt tænke mig, at Novo Nordisk eller hospitalerne lavede en retssag imod mig, hvor de sagde, at det er løgn, det jeg siger.
Jamen, det ved de ikke.
Nej, de holder sig skjult. De holder sig skjult, og de tror, de kan undgå virkeligheden. Men virkeligheden er, manden, der startede med at lave insulin i Danmark, en der hed H.C. Hagedorn, han sagde, at patienterne på hans afdeling på kommunehospitalet i 1919 skulle have grøntsager for at kurere sukkersygen. Ja. Og det hjælper. Man kan styre sukkersygen ved hjælp af grøntsager alene. Mm. Men så fandt han på at lave insulin, og så forsvandt
diætrådet. Ja.
Og så tjente de penge i stedet for. Og nu er Danmark et fremgangsrigt land, men det tramper på halvdøde og døde mennesker på den
men
måde.
Hvordan tror du egentlig, det kan være? Fordi nu sidder jeg her med et brev fra formand, professor, doktor Med fra Motions- og Ernæringsrådet, hvor han også har fået din kostråd tilsendt, ikke? Ja. Og dine forskellige holdninger til, hvordan man burde gøre det. Og så vil han alligevel ikke kommentere på det.
Han er jo pengestyret.
Ja.
Kost- og Ernæringsrådets folk, hvis du går ind på deres hjemmeside og ser på, hvem der betaler Kost- og Ernæringsrådet, så er formanden, den tidligere formand, Arne Astrup, i hvert fald betaler Arla. Mm. Og så vidt jeg ved, producerer de mælk her i landet.
Ja, ja, ja. Så vidt du ved. Ja.
Og kostrådene og pengestyring og pengestyringen er jo direkte forbundet med hinanden. Så det er i virkeligheden en, jeg ved ikke om det er uetisk, eller det er i hvert fald på grænsen af,
det er på grænsen
eller måske over grænsen af, hvad man burde finde sig i, at statens råd, at det skal være betalt af private industri.
Men Emil, hvorfor tror du, at de er så tilbageholdende, eller er det fordi, du griber det forkert an? Fordi den viden, du repræsenterer, er jo helt reelt. Og rigtig mange mennesker kunne have glæde af den. Men når de her såkaldt etablerede folk så gør sådan her, tror du så ikke, det er fordi, at du måske skal prøve en anden form? Så gør opmærksom på de her ting.
Men jeg tror ikke,
altså,
det er problemet.
Altså for eksempel at rejse rundt og holde foredrag, skrive en bog om det, og så tage rundt og holde foredrag, fordi det tror jeg faktisk, folk vil komme og lytte til.
Ja, men altså, problemet er jo, at den pengestyring og den propaganda, der findes fra mejeriernes side, de afviser alt og siger, det er løgne. Men jeg synes, de skulle se på de lande. Jeg synes, der skal undervises i skolerne i de lande, der har den laveste dødelighed, og de lande, der har den højeste dødelighed. Og så se, hvad de spiser. De skulle bare læse en bog. Ja. De skulle bare kunne læse. Men det er jo forbudt her i landet. Altså, Ernæringsrådet kunne jo læse den her bog her. Men det gør de ikke. De finder på deres...
Det gider de jo ikke.
De må ikke læse den bog
der. Den stemmer ikke overens.
Fordi det er lige modsat. Man får jo knogleskørhed af at drikke mælk. Man taber knoglemasse ved at drikke mælk. Ja. Det er jo det mest klamme stof, der findes her i landet, det er mælk. Det indeholder kolesterol i massevis. I forbudte mængder, hvis man ser på, hvad der må være i margarine. Ja. Det er fuldstændig absurd, det der foregår.
Men jeg tænker bare på, når du nu ikke oplever nogen lydhørhed, hverken hos lægerne i Medicinalstyrelsen eller nogen andre steder, fordi de netop er så sovset ind i hinanden, tror du så ikke, at du skulle henvende dig direkte til befolkningen, altså som i dag jo defineres, ikke som befolkningen, men som forbrugere?
Jamen, vi, kan...
Jævnfør, hvor, vi har ikke noget socialministerium mere, vi har et velfærdsministerium.
Vi kan jo sige, for lejligt med dem kan jeg jo sige, at jeg mener, at næringsråd er kriminelt.
Ja.
Jeg mener, at de råd, de giver, de er kriminelle, og jeg beder dem lave en retssag mod mig.
Ja.
Her og nu. Jeg mener, at det er en kriminel organisation, pengestyret, løgnagtig, som voldtager den danske befolkning.
Ja, og for den danske befolknings helbredelse.
Ja. Det er totalt useriøst, det de kommer med. Ja. En professor, han kunne lige så godt være cykelsmed på Nørrebro eller et eller andet. Altså, han siger, det er rent løgn. Jamen, det er jo rent løgn, det han kommer med. Jamen, det fylder os med løgn, simpelthen. Ja. Det er pengestyret og fylder os med løgn. Jeg håber, de laver en retssag mod mig. Det vil jeg håbe. Kan de ikke lave en retssag på højesteret med det samme? Tak.
Jeg kan ikke komme i højesteret med det samme.
Det ved jeg godt.
Jeg tror, du har svært ved at komme igennem hos alle de her officielle personer, professorer og det ene og det andet. Fordi du tror på en eller anden måde dem på deres eksistens.
Nej, de kan jo godt fortsætte deres job.
Ja, ja.
Men de fylder os med løgne.
Du sætter en meget stærk sort streg under.
Jamen, de er fyldt med løgne.
Hvad er det for noget slut?
De er simpelthen fyldt med løgne.
Problemet er bare, at de ikke tager dig alvorligt, og det er jo sådan den sædvanlige måde. Det er det samme, de også gør over for kosttilskud og sådan noget. Så siger de, ja, men det kan ikke dokumenteres, at det virker osv., fordi de vil nemlig ikke selv medvirke til en dokumentation. Og derfor tror jeg, du skal springe det led helt over, og så gå direkte til folk.
Jamen, hvordan skal jeg gøre det? Jeg har jo ingen midler, jeg er bare en enkelt lille mand. Man skal helst være professor for at overhovedet kunne holde foredrag for disse folk. Folk tror kun på titler her i det her samfund. Men vi har det mest elendige sundhedsmæssige samfund, man næsten kan finde på den jord. Så titlerne, altså den mindste mus, er mere ærlig end det, der foregår her i landet. Fordi han lyver ikke. Musen kan ikke lyve.
Men jeg mener musen bare, siger ikke noget. Hvis du gerne vil ud til den brede
kron, jamen, jeg kan jo ikke lave
det.
Jamen, jeg er jo ikke. Hør en gang. Jeg gør det helt uden penge. Jeg er totalt uafhængig, men jeg kan jo heller ikke bruge hele min tid på at lave Danmark om, når det er så elendigt i forvejen. Altså, hvis folk ikke vil høre, hvad jeg siger, så skal de lade være. Jeg kan ikke lave... Du har mange gode... Jamen, så kan du holde foredragene.
Nej, det er ikke min opgave.
Heller ikke min opgave. Det er heller ikke min opgave. Min opgave, synes jeg, som privatmand er jo vel at gøre opmærksom på, at det, der foregår i hele landet, det er forkert.
Ja, men det har du gjort både hos os og i den 11. time og nu endnu en gang hos os. Og så er det, at jeg håber, at der er nogen, der lytter.
Ja, det tror jeg ikke.
Jo, det tror jeg faktisk.
Nej, jeg tror ikke.
Folk er heldigvis mere kvikke oven i pæren, end man tror. Du skal endelig ikke tro, at der ikke er mange mennesker, der kan gennemskue de her ting. Tænk på alle dem, der går til alternativ behandlere og spiser kosttilskud. Og jeg er en af dem. Jeg spiser homeopatisk medicin. Jeg går kun til lægen, hvis jeg ved, at det er noget, det homeopatiske ikke kan klare.
Mm-hmm.
Og det er ikke særlig meget, det homeopatiske ikke kan klare.
Mm-hmm.
Og sammen med mig er der jo en stor gruppe mennesker, der benytter sig af de her ting, fordi de har netop, ligesom dig, fundet ud af, at den officielle lægevidenskab kan man ikke bruge til særlig meget.
Nej.
Og videnskab er i det hele taget...
Det er politisk styret. Det er politisk styret. Pengestyret og politisk styret.
Så derfor så tror jeg, at du tager fejl i at tro, at der ikke er mange mennesker, der vil være interesseret i den her viden.
Jeg har været i den 11. time, hvor der var måske 200.000 mennesker, der har set det.
Mm.
Jeg har ikke fået nogen kommentarer fra de myndigheder, jeg sagde, at de var galt afmarseret.
Ja, myndigheder skal du ikke
regne. Nej. Altså, problemet er, at de holder mund.
Enkeltpersoner?
Ja, der er meget positive kommentarer fra enkeltpersoner.
Ja.
Men myndighederne holder sig tilbage, og de vil altid være bag industrien og bag systemet til den sidste time.
Ja.
Det må være en folkelig rejsning mod det falske fødevareinformation, vi har her i landet. Altså, jeg kender ikke nogen læreanstalt i Danmark, hvor man underviser i The China Study inden for fødevareforskning.
Det gør man.
Fordi det vil ødelægge vores landbrug. Vores landbrug producerer jo kun mættede fedtstoffer, som giver øget dødelighed og sygelighed.
Ja, vi producerer også korn og ærter.
Ja, men er fedtstoffer, hvis du ser på, hvilke fedtstoffer, der produceres, så er 98% af det, vil jeg tro, mættet fedt. Det kommer fra korn og grisen, og det er de farligste dyr, der findes her i landet. Det slår flest mennesker ihjel. Det er en slags gående gaskamre.
Ja, men der er mange holdninger til køer.
Det er ingen løgn. Ja. Man tror, man ser altså mejeriernes propaganda med kokon, der står ude på marken, ser jo sød ud. Men ja, ja, i virkeligheden er fremstillet det som det farligste dyr her i Danmark, der dræber flest mennesker. Det er også en absurd tankegang, men det er nærmere sandheden, end det mejerierne står for.
Ja, men det må jo stå til troende.
Okay.
Du har i hvert fald fremført dit argument, og så håber vi, at der er nogen, der har hørt det og begynder at tænke over det.